Welcome everyone to William Public School online edu classes. Today we are going to start with class 8, chapter number 8, Confronting Marginalization of Social and Political Life. As in our previous chapter, we have already understood the meaning of marginalization, and even we have read about two different groups and their experiences of inequality and discrimination. And now in this chapter we will read about some of the ways in which groups and individuals challenge their existing inequalities, how the marginalized groups of people, they struggled and got a space in constitution. Yes, of course, in this chapter we will see why the constitution of India is something that the marginalized groups invoke in the course of their struggle. The Indian Constitution lays emphasis on principles of equality and justice for all, irrespective of caste, creed, gender or color. These ideas are clearly delineated in fundamental rights, which is one of the most important components of our Constitution. The marginalized groups invoke the rights enshrined in the Constitution in following ways. In fact, there are many instances wherein, due to unrelenting struggle against exploitation and oppression of the marginalized group, the government had to formulate new laws, keeping in mind the spirit of fundamental rights. Now, let us look at some of the safeguards granted in the Constitution that seek to provide economic and social justice to all people. For example, Article number 17. Article 17 of the Indian Constitution prohibits the practice of untouchability. In fact, the practice of untouchability is unlawful and is a punishable crime. Article 15 says that no citizen shall be discriminated against on the grounds of caste, gender, race, religion or place of birth. But time and again, this article has been invoked by Dalits to fight for their rights and to get justice. Similarly, other marginalized groups have drawn upon fundamental rights to protect their interests, particularly cultural and educational rights. The Constitution protects all citizens, especially women, children, against exploitation and forced labor. The Constitution directs the government to ensure for every child free early childhood care and free primary education. The Constitution ensures fair distribution of resources and equal wages for both men and women for some kind of work. Now let us discuss about the measures taken for their upliftment. With the objective of putting into operation the provisions given in the Indian Constitution, government plans and implements some schemes specially directed towards the growth of Dalit and Adivasi communities. Besides this, there are quite a few government-sponsored scholarship schemes to support education of bright students of marginalized groups. Even the Mandal Commission was set up in 1979 under the leadership of B.P. Mandal for deliberation over issues related to reservation and quota meant for the progress of backward classes. In addition to the policies, our country also has specific laws that guard against the discrimination and exploitation of marginalized communities. Apart from providing facilities, the government has also undertaken concrete measures to end inequality innate in the system. One such noteworthy measure is the reservation policy, which is important as well as controversial. According to this policy, a certain percentage of seats are reserved for the Dalits and the Adivasis in education institutions as well as government jobs. For further details, let us read about the Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribes Prevention of Atrocity Act 1989. This law was to address the demands of underprivileged classes that underwent constant persecution and humiliation at the hands of people belonging to the upper caste, especially in the 1970s and 1980s. when this discrimination acquired a violent nature. Around this time, the Dalit group started raising their voice against their discrimination and refused to perform work regards as a hallmark of their caste. They pressurized the government to pass new legislation that would list out the different types of violent practices and lay down more severe penalty to those who engaged in this type of act. Similarly, the Adivasis too organized themselves to fight for land and resources forcefully taken away from them and for equal rights. They too had suffered the wrath of upper classes that resorted to violence to silence the deprived classes. The law that was finally approved after a lot of consideration and discussion distinguishes several levels of crimes that are as follows. First, it lists modes of humiliation that involve physical manhandling as well as any hideous practice of compelling a Dalit or an Adivasi to eat or drink any malicious or disgusting, horrible stuff, forcefully removing their clothes, parading them naked with painted face, or any such act which targeted the self-esteem of the underprivileged classes. It lists action that dispossesses them of their meager resources, which includes to forcefully occupy or cultivate land belonging to a member of deprived class, or force them to work as slaves. The law penalizes for any crime against Dalit or Adivasi women, which includes dishonoring them or assaulting them. As we have already read in earlier chapters, the practice of untouchability has been abolished by the Indian Constitution. However, the manual scavengers in the different parts of the country, like the Bhangis in Gujarat, the Pakhis in Andhra Pradesh, and Sikaliyars in Tamil Nadu, continue to be considered as untouchable. They often live in separate settlements on the outskirts of village and are denied access to the temple, public water facilities, and these people, they are forced to work as a manual scavenger. Let us know, what do we mean by manual scavenging? Manual scavenging refers to the removal of human as well as animal waste manually. Those who do this job of gathering dirt are called as manual scavengers. They use brooms, tin plates and baskets to dispose of the waste. Since they are exposed to such unhygienic conditions, they suffer from serious skin, eye, respiratory and gastrointestinal disease. Those working in urban municipalities earn only rupees 30 to 40 per day, and those working privately are paid much less. You know, this job of manual scavenging is basically done by Dalit women and young girls. According to Andhra Pradesh-based Safai Karamchari Andolan, an organization working with manual scavengers, there are 13 lakh persons from Dalit communities who continue to be employed in this job in this country and who work in the 96 lakh private and community dry latrines managed by municipalities. In 1993, the government passed the Employment of Manual Scavengers and Construction of Dry Latrines Prohibition Act. This law prohibits the employment of manual scavengers as well as constructions of dry latrines. In 2003, the Safai Karamchari Andolan and 13 other organizations and individuals, including 7 scavengers, they filed a PIL in the Supreme Court. The petitioners, they complained that manual scavenging still existed and is continued in government undertakings like the railways. The petitioners, they sought enforcement of their fundamental rights. The court observed that the number of manual scavengers in India had increased since the 1993 law. It directed every department, ministry of union government and state government to verify the fact within 6 months. If manual scavenging was found to exist, then the government department has to actively take up a time-bound program for their liberation and rehabilitation. Thus, in spite of the passing of Employment of Manual Scavengers and construction of Dry Latrine Prohibition Act, our country has not been able to do away with this dehumanizing practice. This problem does not only stem from poverty or lack of awareness, but seems to be deep-rooted in our caste system. The Act of 1989 is equally important for the Adivasis, as it clearly states that they cannot be removed from the land that is traditionally theirs. This Act merely reiterates what has been promised to the tribals in the Constitution, that the land belonging to them cannot be sold or bought by any non-tribal group of people, and in the event of violation of this law, the tribals have the right to reclaim their land. You know, there was a very popular Adivasi activist. Her name was C.K. Jani, who fought for the rights of Adivasi people. Even she suggested that the non-tribal encroachers in the form of timber merchants, paper mill, etc., those who came to exploit the tribal land, or they forced the tribal people to evict their land from the traditional forest, they should be punished. She has also noted that in cases where tribals have already been evicted and cannot go back to their land, they must be compensated. That is, the government must draw up plans and policies for them to live and work elsewhere. After all, governments spend large sums of money on building industrial or other projects on land taken from tribals. So, why should they be reluctant to spend even very modest amount on rehabilitating the displaced? So, we can conclude by saying that the existence of a right or a law or even a policy on paper does not mean that it exists in reality. People have had to constantly work on or make efforts to translate these into principles that guide the action of their fellow citizens or even their leaders. The desire of equality, dignity and respect, it's not new. It has existed in different forms throughout our history, as we have already seen in this chapter. Similarly, even in a democratic society, similar process of struggle, writing, negotiating and organizing needs to continue. So with this, we end our chapter. Happy learning, everyone.